Hey everybody, welcome to the Sanctum. As you can see here by this terrifying record in front of us, we're going to be taking a look at, well, what seems to be a lost art nowadays, the horror sound effects record. And with me today is my compatriot in the Sanctum, Russell James. And we're both going to sit here and discuss our memories, fond or otherwise, of this terrifying record by Pickwick Records. And that is why we're entitling this episode, Middle-Aged Monsters Talk Terror. And away we go.
Well, I'm excited to be in the Sanctum for the first time. It's a lot of fun. One of the things I'd like to talk about is this record here is actually the first horror sound effects record I ever owned. And the one that we're looking at right now is my actual copy from when I was about 4 years old. As a monster kid, I was a big fan of the song Monster Mash. I had heard it around the age of four on the radio. And because we didn't have the internet or the availability of bringing music up on demand, my mother went out to find me a recorded version. And this is the one she came back with. This is not the Bobby Boris Pickett version of the Monster Mash. This is the Sounds of Terror Monster Mash. And I got a lot more than I bargained for from this record because this record scarred me for life. I mean, it's, as we'll see as we listen to it, it's a really sick piece of Halloween entertainment. And I'm really excited to be able to talk about it with Dr. Durant.
Well, we're excited to have you here. And yeah, I have to agree with you on that, Russell. And as a matter of fact, I think when we first met and we're becoming friends, this record came up in many discussions when we discussed things all horror related. And anybody that has owned this record knows how terrifying it actually is. And that's one of the kind of the cool thing about this being a 70s monster kid was that they would release just really horrifying stuff like this for children. And this was also the first horror sound effects record that I owned as well. And as a matter of fact, I had never heard the song Monster Mash until I got this record. So to me, this was the definitive version of the song Monster Mash.
Right.
I hadn't even heard Bobby Boris Pickett's version. And later when I heard Bobby Boris Pickett's version, I didn't think it was as good because I was so used to having grown up listening to this one over and over again.
Yeah, the Pickwick Players version.
Right.
I mean, but just look at this album cover, this record cover. Even now, it kind of disturbs me. I'm kind of having flashbacks to when I was a kid. This is some really gruesome artwork. I mean, what's with all the blood? I mean, like, you know, you don't see blood on kids, I guess what's supposed to be kids' entertainment anymore, but there's so much blood. It's like there's blood pouring out of Dracula.
He's in front of a wall of blood, basically. Like he's at the Amityville Horror House or something. It's dripping from his fingers, it's dripping from his mouth, it's dripping from his anus, it looks like, or something like that. But you're right. It's full of blood. And I always thought this version, and now that I'm older, I realize it really looks like the Dracula from Brides of Dracula. Like he's got that blonde look to him, which I guess is supposed to be more like the moonlight shining now that I'm looking at it on his head. But, you know, as I got older, I'm always like, oh, that kind of looks like the blonde from Brides of Dracula, you know, from Hammer. But yeah, even the font of all the words, and it's like the horror hit Monster Mash, Sounds of Terror. Listen to this horror if you dare. Like all of it's just terrifying. It's all dripping gore and fear. And I mean, that was a big thing back then, right? Like was all those sort of cover versions of songs that Peter Pan and Pickwick would put out. Like you get all the sort of pseudo hits. It was sort of the kids' bops of the 70s. Mm. But it was, you know, Purple People Eater, but it wasn't by the original version. It was
exactly
by the Pickwick people. Matter of fact, I remember I had a sound, I had a record of TV theme songs because I loved the theme song to The $6 Million Man. And I got that, and it was some bad Peter Pan Records band that did it. But I loved that. And the song I loved most on that record, funny enough, was the theme to Police Woman.
All right, so I mean, looking at this thing right now, I just kind of want to—I want to indulge the audience a little bit with what my experience was when I first heard this. Again, like I said, I was about 4 years old. My mother picked this record up for me at, I believe, a Zayer store in Massachusetts. I can kind of remember seeing her bringing it out to me from the store, and we brought this record home, and I can remember sitting in my parents' living room on the floor, looking at this horrible, horrible picture of Dracula and what began to unfold after the Monster Mash tune is stuff that I think to this day informs my sensibilities as a horror aficionado, you know, what I like in terms of theater of the mind, if you will, the darkness of it all. But yeah, I'm excited to listen to this because I have. What I will say is I've only ever listened to this record probably 5 times in my entire life.
Really?
Yeah. When I heard it the first time, I couldn't sleep that night. I was terrified, and I broke down into tears. And I told my mother, it was as if I had been cursed by the Ring video. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like I'd been cursed by it. And what had been heard could not be unheard. And all of the dread was there. And I remember breaking down into tears and saying, we have to get rid of this record. It cannot be in this house, I remember saying. And my mother realized I was hysterical and she was trying to calm me down. And so she left the bedroom and went to talk to my father, and she came back, and my father said, I'm going to break that record into 100 pieces, and I'm going to throw it away, and I'm going to bury it, I think he said, or something like that. It won't be here tomorrow. So that made me feel better, I guess, although I was still walking around kind of in a daze for weeks and months afterwards. Fast forward a few years later, come to find out my parents didn't in fact throw it away. They just put it in a closet somewhere. And when I was older, they brought it back out for me to hear. And so the second time I heard it, I think I was in fourth grade.
Right.
Which would have made me like 10 years old. And even then I didn't want to hear it again.
Right.
I was just, I hid it myself at that point. And I think I put it away in a drawer or tucked it away in my records somewhere. And anytime I'd be flipping through my records looking for a Kiss record or something, and I'd have to speed past it, you know? He's looking at me right now, and it's I kind of still feel those childhood fear vibes now looking at it. And I think fast forward to college is when I heard it again.
Right.
So that'd be like the third. And maybe a few times after that, I played it for friends just like as a joke saying, you know, this really screwed with me as a kid, and now we're going to listen to it again, and I'll have some more to say, I'm sure.
Yeah. Now my experience is similar to yours, but a bit different as to how I obtained this record. It was the same thing. I think I had been out trick-or-treating, and I probably was around the same age as you, around 4 or 5 years old. I think I got the record when it first came out, and I had heard a horror sound effects record on. Someone was playing it at their house, and I begged my mom. I'm like, I need one of those records. I need it. I need it. And this is what we got. I don't remember where we got it or how we got it, whether my mom came home with it or I was with her. But for some reason, I have a memory of getting it at either a Woolworths or a supermarket, because supermarkets would sell this stuff too.
Yeah.
But cut to, you play this record, and the first song is the Monster Mash. You're like, oh, this is going to be fun. This is really neat. Like, and I was like, like I said, I never heard the Monster Mash before, and I dug it. Cut to like the first thing, and like, you're right. Like, each one of these is so Grand Guillaume, like, style little vignettes. And I was the same as you. I was terrified. I'm like, what? This is horrifying. And some of these to this day, I distinctly remember, and I can hear them over and over in my head, how terrifying they were. Now, I did the same thing. I didn't want the record out of my house because I was still such a horror fan, but I would hide it every night when I went to bed because I was afraid that either the vampire would come off the record or the werewolf on the back would come off the record. And if you want to hold on for 1 second, grab me that there on the ground, would you, Russell? Now, as you can see, I have my original version too, which is much worse for wear than Russell's. The same thing, I think my mom had kept all our records, and when she moved, I was digging through the records and I found it, and I was absolutely thrilled. And what I want to show on the back is, here we go again.
Blood.
Yeah, and look at the three words that are bold. Horror, madness, terror.
Yeah. Yeah, and if I'm looking at this now, it says that the production copyright date is 1974, Pickwick International. So when this thing was pressed, I was 3 years old. And again, this must have just been pulled out every year, you know,
right,
for the holidays. So like I said, I think I was about four. I think I was in kindergarten when I heard this. But it's also saying Sounds of Terror Stereo, Pickwick International, a scary product of Pickwick International, printed in the USA. Written by the great Frank Daniel and produced by Wade Deming. And those are people that I guess people who are really into their sound effects or story records may know. I don't know anything about these guys, but I thank them for screwing with me as a child.
Yeah, and it's amazing that they were given credit, because a lot of times when you look at these old Peter Pan records or Power records, there's no credits given to who the voice actors were or who produced them necessarily. And if you read some of the copy on this, it's got horror. This is a trip into the uncharted regions of the unnatural world of horror, a region where the supernatural takes over the minds of men. It is that place where the fiends lurk, ready to plunge their fangs death deep. If you dare, turn out the lights and play this record on your phonograph. Gasp and scream as the victim pleads in vain for mercy or quick death. If your heart is too weak for this journey into terror, do not play this record. Your nerves will jar to the grotesque inhumanity of man to man within the screams you hear, maybe your own, after this diabolical detour into madness. So, I mean, that right there is just, I mean, that's scary now reading that as an adult.
Right. I mean, who, obviously nobody was concerned about child welfare. I mean, who talks about, you know, gasp and scream as the victims plead in vain for mercy or quick death?
Right.
I mean, you know, what child entertainment now talks about, you know, mercy killing? Yeah, like in the merchandise, you know, in the ad copy or anything, you know, it's just.
And the next part gets even better, because you're talking, this is a kid's record, right?
Yeah.
So they say, can you stand the shock of hearing the Exorcist battle Satan? So they're obviously trying to ride on the coattails of the Exorcist, which had just come out.
Yep.
Came out in 74, right? It had to have.
Yeah.
There's no way, I mean.
Yeah, it had
and to so, have been. So they know that it was, you know, they're trying to ride on the coattails of the Exorcist film on a kid's record. The Exorcist, which is still one of the most terrifying movies ever made. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's, you know, what mom is going to look at this and be like, oh, well, The Exorcist is on this. This is a perfect record to bring home to my 5-year-old.
Yeah. Hear the unearthly sounds of the possession of the soul. Listen if you dare. Will the burning of the witches at the stake unhinge your mind? Does the screaming amongst the flames shatter your sanity? The evil blackness within this record is a journey into the unbelievable terror. Yeah.
So it's telling you right on the back that this is the most vile, disturbing piece of entertainment that has ever been put together for kids. It's horror personified, like man's inhumanity to man, madness, terror. You know, it's like your soul, you're gonna go insane if you listen to this record.
Exactly, and I you know, it's funny because I think in some ways it really did work that number on me anyway.
But I still think it's great though. It's like it's just a record about like, you know,
oh yeah,
the insanity, and then it's like, and we've got a really neat version of the Monster Mash.
And explain this quickly.
Okay, this is another version that I picked up on eBay recently, and the reason I wanted to get it obviously was because if you're a fan of the Sanctum, you know I enjoy that patina that shows up. And this one had the price tag on it and was still in its original shrink wrap, keeping it in pretty pristine condition. Russell's was in pretty pristine condition because it had been hidden away for so long. But mine had been beaten and is scratched and is torn up. Yeah, pull it out. We're going to take a look at the actual record itself. And you can see it's got this, that was another thing, it's got this great illustration on the label. We've got that Dracula there again, right? And that record's pretty good. It's in mint condition. It's obviously never been played, or maybe just once. And again, I wonder how many records are out there like this that people played and like, I'm never playing this again. It's terrifying. Now, you're going to see which one of us is a lunatic here, because this is my record now that Russell's holding up. And you can see it's worn. It's scratched. There's fingerprints all over it. Because I was obsessed with this. This was almost like a kid's version of Faces of Death.
Yeah, definitely a good comparison. Oh, mine does actually have.
Oh, yours has? Yeah, see, mine's gone.
That's mint. I mean, that inside there is.
We can't see it in the camera. Okay. His had the record sleeve, mine didn't. His is in pretty good condition.
It's a little dirty. But no scratches.
But tell us the a little bit there. Tell us the story about what happened to this record and how it came back into your possession again.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, interesting. I think about this record every Halloween. You know, I think about putting it on, or you know, it actually had fallen out of my possession for. Oh, God, maybe a good 10, 15 years. I had lent it to a friend. No, what happened was we were playing it back in the 90s. Nobody had a record player anymore, right? We were all listening to CDs or cassettes. We had gotten rid of all of our vinyl. So my friend, his mother had one of those big Hutch-style record players down in the family room. So I brought this over so this must have been maybe the fourth time I listened to this record. And we listened to it on that record player down in his family room. And then I left it with him. And I forgot about it. And I thought it was lost forever because 10, 15 years, you know, we had all moved on, made many moves, many different apartments and whatnot. But he held on to it. And I was telling him about it. We were talking, and he said, I have it.
Wow.
Last year, he goes, I still have that record, and it's yours, so come get it. And I did, and here it is.
That's what I always love about stories like that. Like, it's like, not only did it come back into you, but it was your record. You were meant to have this again, or this record, you know, you are cursed by this record, yeah. And you are never to be free of it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we may be making a mistake putting it on tonight.
Yeah, now, I can distinctly remember some of the specific tracks. I remember Jack the Ripper. I remember the Phantom of the Opera one, because he always does this, you know, I will always have your beauty for my own.
Right.
And then the Buried Alive one is one of the ones that terrified me more.
Yeah.
And I think like the first side of the record is more traditional monsters. And then the second side is... Isn't it titled Man's Inhumanity to Man?
Yeah, so side one is titled Famous Monsters and Ghouls, and side two is Man's Inhumanity to Man.
Right, and the Man's Inhumanity to Man side was the side that just really screwed me up. As a matter of fact, I played side one and would refuse to play side two a lot, probably just because it was so terrifying. But every once in a while, I delve into it to be like, can I make it through? And then I just have nightmares. It'd be awful. Well, why don't we start off here by playing that glorious version of the Monster Mash that kicks off this album, and see if it sounds like we remember.
Sounds good.
You want me to what? Ew. These two middle-aged fools have awakened Jody and I from our deep sleep to play a stupid record for them. So, without further ado, here is the Monster Mash from their terrifying record, Sounds of Terror. Jody, play the record.
Working in the lab late one night, when my eyes beheld an eerie sight. For my monster from the slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
Wow.
From my laboratory in the castle east.
Wow.
To the master bedroom for the vampire's feet.
Wow.
The ghouls all came from their humble abode.
Wow.
To get a jolt from my electrode.
They did the mash.
They did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
They did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They did the mash.
They did the monster mash.
Wow.
The zombies were having fun.
In a shoot, wow.
The party had just begun.
In a shoot, wow.
The guests included Wolfman,
in a shoot, wow.
Dracula, and his son.
Wow.
The scene was rocking, all were digging the sounds.
Wow.
Igor on chains, backed by his baying
wow.
hounds.
Wow.
The puffing bangers were about to arrive.
Wow.
With their vocal group, the Crypt Kick of Fire.
They played the mash.
They played the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard
they
smash.
They played the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They played the mash.
They played the monster mash.
Wow.
Out from his coffin, Drax's voice did ring.
Wow.
Seems he was troubled by just
wow.
one
wow.
thing.
Wow.
Opened the lid and shook his fist and
wow.
said, whatever happened to my Transylvanian twist?
It's now the mash.
It's now the monster mash.
The monster mash.
And it's a graveyard smash.
It's now the mash.
It's caught on in a flash.
It's now the mash.
It's now the monster mash.
Wow.
Now everything is cool. Drax a part of the band.
Wow.
And my monster mash is the hit of the land.
Wow. Wow.
For you, the living, this mash was meant too.
Wow.
When you get to my door, tell them Boris sent you.
And you can mash.
And you can monster mash.
The monster mash.
And do my graveyard
then
smash.
You can mash.
You catch on in a flash.
Then you can mash.
Then you can monster mash.
Mash.
Tattoo as a young boy.
Okay, so what did you think of that?
Not the best version of the Monster Mash.
No, and that's the first version I heard. And now, having heard Bobby Boris pick his version, it's definitely way better. The guy is singing it like he's just reading it off a script, the guy doing the Bobby Boris pick apart.
Yeah, he seems to get more into it as it goes along. At first, he's a little off the beat, too. You know, it's like he's not... Yeah, he's having to catch up, but he seems to catch the fever near the end.
Right, and he's using that, like, I think the word's supposed to be mash good at the end that Bobby Boris Pickett says, but he sounds like he's saying mashed ghoul, like, or mashed gruel. And every once in a while you could pick up like he had this, I don't know if it was a New York accent.
A little bit, yeah.
Like, your graveyard smash. And it's,
yeah,
and
it's like, there's definitely some weird vocal thing going on there. And but I what I remember, too, when I heard it is, again, I'd be staring into Dracula's eyes while I was listening to it. And I think I think the first time I heard it, I thought he was singing it. Because the thing I didn't know about the Monster Mash is that I didn't know who Boris Karloff was or any of that stuff, so I didn't get all the, you know, Bobby Boris Pickett, and I always thought the Monster Mash was sung by Dracula, but I'm guessing it was sung who's singing it?
It's supposed to be Dr. Frankenstein
right? Yeah.
Yeah. And it's you wouldn't know who Boris Karloff was by listening to that, because that guy does not do a Boris Karloff imitation.
Yeah, and the orchestration was very, very tinny. Like, it sounded like it was all going through maybe one of those electric piano organ things,
yeah, from exactly, when we were, right,
you buy
right
at Sears, you know, that had like a bossa nova beat thrown on it. Yeah, so
it was a one take deal. They probably, even the backup singers were like, you know, they kind of had this Archie's version to them. They're like, you know, it was funny. But so as a kid, though, I loved it. I thought it was like, you know, I'm a kid. What do I know about music at that age?
Right.
And it's hip. It's happy. It's fun.
Yep.
And I'm like, oh, this is going to be kind of cool. I love vampires and Dracula. And I had never heard the Monster Mash before. And then we go in to the first track. Judy, they want the record again.
Lovers, the moon is a thing of beauty, but to this man it is a deadly curse. When the moon is full, this miserable wretch turns into a hairy, snarling half-man, half-beast. He prowls the night, his fangs thirsty for human blood. He is a werewolf. Thirst for knowledge, Dr. Jekyll experimented with his own body by swallowing a diabolical chemical mixture. His hair grew wildly, his features distorted as his mind was claimed by his evil alter ego, and he stalked into the fog-bound streets of London with murder in his heart. He was now the heinous Mr. Hyde.
Yeah.
mind slowly stirs. He bursts his steel bonds and stands. Frankenstein's monster. Evil killer prowled the foggy nights. He stalked the cobblestone streets of old London town, his long black cloak concealing long razor-sharp knives to slash unsuspecting victims. Never caught by the bobbies of Scotland Yard, this mad fiend was known to the terrified inhabitants as Jack the Ripper.
Uncharted island in the Pacific, a giant ape was captured and transported by freighter to New York City. His moment of fame was challenged by a prehistoric sea monster that surfaced off the coast of Japan. Eventually, they met in deadly combat, a titanic death struggle of the giants. The world trembled to the thunder of the raging conflict until the victor pounded his massive chest and bellowed his roar of victory. King Kong.
Thank you.
In Transylvania, there is a legend that has become a symbol of terror throughout the world. In the dead of night, an evil transformation takes place within the castle of Count Dracula. After he rises from his coffin, he turns into a giant bat and flies through the night, seeking blood from the throats of his victims. A vampire of death. An early American named Ichabod Crane was terrified one night when he observed a gruesome sight in the moonlight. A ghostly white stallion galloped across the countryside carrying a ghostly rider. From the black hollow at his severed neck, screaming his maniacal laughter, it was the Headless Horseman.
Egyptian pharaoh died in 400 BC and was entombed in a pyramid. Centuries later, a greedy archaeologist plundered the crypt for his own financial gain. He accidentally roused the ancient ruler from his comatose state. Now the mummy drags his bandaged and tormented body through the night, seeking his revenge.
opera has always given beauty and joy to the world. But once, a famous opera singer became deformed and horribly scarred after he was burned in a fire on stage. He fled the civilized society of the music he loved and hid in the remote darkness of the Paris Opera House. This misshapen being became known as the Phantom of the Opera.
Okay, so that was side one of Sounds of Terror.
Not too bad.
Yeah, pretty standard horror tropes there. You've got, you know, Frankenstein, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, the mummy, things like that. And as a kid, I remember that I always did enjoy the first side better because being such a monster kid, I loved them playing those old tropes. But I'm interested to hear your thoughts on what you thought of some of the vignettes.
Yeah, well, it's funny listening to it now. I'm transported back to when I first heard it. And I think, I think I remember being able, okay, I can sit with this. I can hang with this as a kid. You know, I was still frightened by that cover, but this was okay. You know, this was some interesting monster stuff. So when I listened to... One of the things I can say that I do like about this is these guys really are trying to do something unique, I think, with each of those, right?
I was thinking the same thing.
They're taking some chances. They're not, you know, they're swinging and a few misses. We'll get into that. But they were trying to do things differently than I think other people might have.
Right.
You know, right from the beginning. So, like, starting with that first track, The Wolfman. Using real dog sounds or wolf sounds or whatever it was. Yeah. Obviously, they had some sound effects, recordings and things like that. And rather than having somebody, which would have been kind of, may have worked, who knows. They went with that. And then there was some good screaming that went with that.
Yeah, that awful mewling of whatever it was that was being, it almost sounded like an animal being killed or a baby. Like, even as a kid, I never knew what that was. That, like,
There was a lot of nice blending of sounds. They seem to be using the acoustical spaces really nice. Like, there's a lot of nice ambiance and echoes and things like that. So it definitely does kind of allow you to... There's some depth to the sound. So, and I noticed that through most of the tracks. But, good solid effort, that first track. Good way to start the record.
Yeah, I thought so too. And I like the... I like... What I found throughout the entire first half, and they do it in the second half too, is that little, that sort of horror host introducing each vignette. And it always reminded me of like the beginning of a house of mystery or a house of secrets with like the Cain or Abel coming out or Tales from the Crypt. Like, here's what I'm going to tell you. And then here's the story, and it unfolds. There's some really great, there's a lot of great Foley work in these and sound effects, like you said. And yeah, it's like, it's like they're not just, they actually put some effort into this to make it like super creepy.
Yeah.
And I think we go into the next one, Mr. Hyde. I enjoyed that a lot. That guy should have sang the Monster Mash because he does a great Karloff when he's introducing the Mr. Hyde story. And I think it's a really cool story, the way they do the sound effects. Like, you hear the glass clinking, you hear him sipping the potion and drinking it, and then sort of, you know, the beakers and the things crashing and breaking and him turning into Mr. Hyde. And then, of course, we're introduced to that first scream that they use throughout the record. They used it a couple of times on this, that woman's...
Yeah, that was definitely a canned piece of sound that gets repeated over and over.
Right, but it's still terrible. It's like that, like,
Yeah.
And I remember as a kid, that scream always kind of freaked me out.
Yeah, and I don't know how many actors were involved in this. I imagine maybe two or three different people switching off, doing different voices and whatnot. But whoever is working, these guys laugh really well.
Right.
A lot of maniacal laughter. And that was the first thing that I noticed with the Jekyll and Hyde is that disturbed laughter was really, really effective.
And great voice work, like you said. Like, and I think as a kid, like sometimes I would be comforted by some of the narrators before, like, oh, this guy's the cool guy. He's too, like, you know, the Mr. Hyde guy was kind of scary, right? Mm. Or the Wolfman. But like, you know, the Jack the Ripper guy has that sort of London accent, so he's kind of soothing. And yeah. I remember like the guy doing the, well, we'll get to that when we get down to things. So then we have Mr. Hyde, like we talked about. And the next one is Frankenstein.
Yeah, one of the notes that I made was a good narration. This was the first time I think I noticed the narration. So somebody was kind of doing a Karloff-y sounding.
Right.
Yeah. And some really strange electrical noises going on in the background. Yeah. Not your typical, you know, like the widget sounds. Some obviously they were in a power plant or something and recorded right. some really, really nice sort of background noise. Go ahead.
Well, what I thought was interesting was they do the Karloff for the narrator, like you said, but then the Frankenstein they do is one of the creepiest Frankensteins I've ever heard because it's this. It's like moaning
yeah.
and it's in pain at being alive. And it reminds me of like what Bernie Wrightson's Frankenstein would sound like if you've ever seen a picture yeah, of like yeah, Wrightson's Frankenstein. Yeah. It's dragging its feet and it's like, ooh, like it's like, yeah. why am I alive? Why, what's happened to me? Why am I back? You know, it's just through those moans. Like, so that's the great work that the guy, you know. I don't know if that's what he was going for, but that's what I'm reading into it when I listen to
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I think they were really trying to do something different. Like they were having some fun with exploring some different textures and some sound mixing and things like that. And I think that was the track that I first liked. I noticed that depth of the sound. You know, you can hear him coming from what seems like a long distance away when clearly I'm sure he's just standing in front of a mic and there's somebody working faders and whatnot, or maybe in the post. But I that one was very good. That's probably one of my favorites out of the bunch.
Yeah, that was a good one. And then the next we come up is Jack the Ripper. What do you think about that one?
You know, getting back to the narration, you know, the guy wasn't really trying to put on too thick of a British accent,
right.
but he was okay. He kind of kept that worked. I think I might have snickered a little bit, but you know, they nothing's really over the top.
Right.
Nothing really on this first side was especially over the top or hokey.
Yeah, I agree, and that would be the first one where it comes in where he's doing that sort of London bobby accent. But I enjoyed it. And here's one of the things that I was thinking about while I was listening to this, and it never really struck me. But growing up, you and I as monster kids, right?
Mm-hmm.
Jack the Ripper was a part of pop culture legend to us, like horror, right? Like
right.
They do it on Gilligan's Island. They do a version with like Jack the Ripper. They do different things. We always learned about Jack the Ripper. Having him on this record, in history, he was a serial killer that killed prostitutes. So it's the equivalent of having like Charles Manson or John Wayne Gacy, like a little vignette starring them, right? Like he's not a monster. He was a serial killer.
Yeah, and not to, because I don't really know my Jack the Ripper history too well, but at least on this track, he basically just walks up to a woman and stabs her a few times.
Right, and that was the part of the other Foley work is where you hear him slashing her over and over right. and over, and you can hear the knife going in. It's like, ch-ch-ch-ch.
Yeah.
And it's and then you've got that great, you know, the Bobby chasing him away.
I do think, yeah, that this was the track, I think, when the record started to take that dark turn
yep.
when I was a kid. Hearing that stabbing, I think I remember trying to process that in my head and say, is that what I'm hearing?
Right. Because
if that's what I'm hearing, this is terrible.
Yep. And the next one, they call it, well, the Dracula, but I think he calls it, the guy says, the Vampire of Death.
Oh, no, before that is the King Kong.
Oh, you're right. You're right. I'm sorry.
Yeah, King Kong, that pretty big fail there, I think. That was, I don't know what they were, why they decided to go that route with, you know, why not just sort of tell the climbing the Empire State Building or
airplanes and stuff like that, right?
But instead they went for this Godzilla versus King Kong, but I couldn't picture what I was supposed to be seeing.
Because first of all, they don't mention Godzilla, right? They just say the giant lizard outside of Tokyo. So like, yeah. And then they go King Kong, and then I don't know if they were imitating the scene from Godzilla versus King Kong where the octopus comes out of the sea.
Oh, geez. Uh-huh.
But it sounded like a snake at the same time. And then King Kong's growl just sounded like a wild cat, a leopard or a lion or a tiger or something.
The sound of big cats being maybe slowed down a little bit. But yeah, that one. And then just the sound of, I think, what was supposed to be moving through vegetation, through jungle or something, but it just kind of sounded like somebody was like whipping at some grass or something. It's just, yeah.
And if you do King Kong, you're not going to do booming footsteps, like no.
Right.
Boom. You know, they didn't do any of that.
Yeah, I don't know. that was definitely the weak one on that first side, I think.
Yep. And then I agree with, I'm sorry, I jumped the gun, but the next one was Dracula, Vampire of Death.
Dracula.
And as a kid, and I think you and I were kind of, we were whispering off to the sidelines, I never knew what that freaking squeal was.
Mm.
I like, dee, 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 dee. And you're telling me he's supposed to be a bat.
Yeah, because that's sort of what the narrator's talking about, is how he rises from his coffin, stretches and yawns.
Yeah.
Which is something I still remember from being a kid.
Scratches his nuts.
Yeah. I never once saw Dracula in any of the movies get out of the coffin and just be like, oh shit, I can't do this today.
Another day of drinking blood. Oh my god.
So that
bat traffic's gonna be insane today. Look at it out there. It's a full moon.
But yeah, the sound is, I think, supposed to be the high pitched screeching of bats and then the flapping of bat wings. Probably the second big fail on the first side.
But then it changes into this weird sexual thing.
The
woman is like moaning and you hear a sucking. So she's not in pain. She's just sort of like, oh, like, you know,
yeah.
That was an odd one.
I think, and I think, again, that's them sort of taking some chances and going more hammer with their idea of Dracula, where the experience isn't so much horrific as it's sexually liberating in some strange way.
Next was the Headless Horseman.
Yeah, more of that diabolical laughter.
Yeah.
Really well done, coming from far away. I saw it in my head. I could see clearly what they were trying to do. Very simple, very...
A laugh worthy of the Joker or the Green Goblin. Like, it was really good, and it was... you just hear the footsteps of the horse clopping and the laughter, and then it sort of fades off, right?
Yeah, and that's one of the things I like, is that, you know, the we fade in and we fade out, you know, and in some weird way, the story's still continuing in your mind after it's over. That was good.
And then this one I had a little bit of issue with, The Mummy.
Right.
The narrator, for some reason, is doing an Indian accent or what seems to be Southeast Asian.
Sounded like
and
that.
And you have this harpsichord music playing in the background, like we were in India or something.
Yeah, like a sitar type thing going on. Yeah, there was definitely that, sure.
And then it sort of just seemed like kind of a rehash of Frankenstein to me, because you heard some digging for some reason, and then you have the mummy moaning and dragging its foot, which I liked.
Yeah.
And then I kind of liked it that it faded out, like the mummy walked past us and it's going off to find its victim in the night.
Yeah, no victim in
right.
that one.
Right, no one got killed or no one screamed. I was waiting for the guy to be digging the dirt like, oh, no,
you know, right.
Or a crushing head or something like that. So that was probably the weakest one for me out of the bunch.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And then this one is my favorite, the last one, Phantom of the Opera.
Yeah, that one held up really well. Still very good.
It's the one I always remember that stuck with me over the years. And I love the narrator. I love the organ music that they're playing, the sound effects of the opera house crumbling down around him, and the guy doing the voice of the Phantom, and just repeating that thing over. It's a very simple thing. He's just singing and singing until the whole place collapses around him. But right. I love that one. And to this day, it's my favorite. It was my favorite as a kid, and I love it now. All right. Well, let's check out side two.
To die is a fate that must come to us all. But how horrible to be buried alive. Imagine the hell of lying trapped in your own coffin, your heart beating wildly, every gasping breath using up the valuable oxygen. This death by suffocation has befallen many a demented creature after attempts to claw himself out of his entombment.
Colonial days, as the United States of America was being built by brave and honest people, there were times when superstition ran rife and hate claimed the minds of our countrymen. In New England, the mere accusation of being a witch was enough to sentence a person to be tied to a stake and burned alive. This terrible form of colonial justice, with its unfair court proceedings, sent many an innocent woman to her fiery death.
Light the fire!
The possession of one's mind by the devil is a horrifying specter. To purge the devil from the soul of man, the power of religion is invoked to fight the demonic forces. Listen to the scourging of the devil by this exorcist.
May the power of Christ compel you. 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 May Christ compel you. May the power of 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 Christ compel you.
May the power of Christ compel you.
From the deep, deep darkness of the Pacific Ocean came a creature that terrorized Tokyo, rampaged through Hawaii, then began to claw and crush its way into San Francisco. Nothing could stop the incredible giant crab. During the French Revolution, bloodthirsty mobs rioted in the streets of Paris and dragged their royal victims to be beheaded by the guillotine. The thirst for vengeance by the howling mob was satisfied only when the victim was decapitated and his head rolled in a basket beneath the bloody blade.
Oh,
the steaming jungles of Haiti, the eerie sound of the voodoo drums tell us that this is the night the living dead walk. From the darkness they shuffle, eyes glazed with death, hands clawing for blood. The moans and cries mix with the sounds of the jungle as voodoo claims all in this cult of tropical terror. The zombies walk. A sailing ship often included unfortunate wretches who were kidnapped while either drunk or drunk. For an infraction of the captain's orders, the offender could be punished by the inhuman practice of keel hauling. The arms of the victim were lashed to long ropes held by the crew. He was thrown off the bow of the ship and dragged along the barnacle-encrusted keel. Often, the battered and bleeding body fell prey to man-eating sharks.
Is the crew ready, Mr. Bosun? Then throw the beggar over.
Times, the truth was sometimes pulled out of a man's soul along with his tongue. Grotesque forms of cruelty were prevalent in the torture chamber. Here, the infamous rack was employed to stretch the prisoner out of his puny body into agonizing madness.
Brave astronauts have walked the craters of the moon, but one mission into outer space turned into a horror for the whole world. A space capsule brought back an alien form of life that ran amok. A shimmering slime that daily grew in size. Its bulk slithered in its oozing slime, which was an instant poison if touched. No bullets, gas, or flame could stop the reign of terror by the Blob.
We're at 12 minutes now since entry into the Earth's atmosphere.
We have the helicopters out the window.
The graveyard at night has driven many a poor soul to utter madness. If you value your sanity, do not stray into the evil darkness that surrounds the tombs, crypts, and mausoleums. Here, ghosts wail and moan, skeletons rattle, trying to escape their imprisoning coffins. Grimacing skulls gasp a death rattle. You have entered the nightmare of lost souls.
So that was side two.
Man's inhumanity to man.
Yeah, real distinct difference from the first side, isn't it? It's sort of all this like horrible things through history with like these random 50s sci-fi things thrown in as well.
Yeah. It was like they still had a couple of monster ideas that they needed to carry over. And they brought them in.
Yeah, this is the side I remember the least because it wasn't because I didn't like it, but this was the side that terrified me more than the first side. The first side I could deal with because it was monsters and Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and you know, vampires and stuff. And the second side was just this trip through insanity, really.
Yeah, just a lot of misery, you know, and things that being a 4-year-old child, you really shouldn't have been exposed to at such a high concentration.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, you know, you watch a movie, let's say, like I, you know, another thing that terrified me around the same age was the film Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. That's the one where Christopher Lee is impaled on a cross at the end and blood comes out of his eyes. And it's just this really... But that's one thing, one scene in a movie, right? And
right.
It's just, you know, that thing bothers me. But this was a concentrated 30 minutes of just terrible things that my mind was conjuring because of the sounds.
Right.
And what was being explained. Surprisingly, I don't know why anyone thought... But again, maybe this record wasn't made for kids. Maybe it was just made, you know, for older people to enjoy as well. But, you know, I certainly got it at far too young and an impressionable an age.
Yeah, I don't know. My guess would be, as far as I know, Pickwick Records, and I'll have to research it more, but I thought they specifically geared their records towards children. And they are clearly saying, hey, the Monster Mash is on this thing, you know, for some kid. But then they've got this horrible, bloody cover. But you're right. Like, the whole second half of this album, to me, it's like this second half is like the soundtrack to the covers of eerie publication magazines,
sure,
which were the same thing, which were just these, they had sort of relaxed the code a little bit, I guess, in the 70s, or things were a little bit, so like there was more terrifying stuff like this geared towards kids, you know.
Yeah,
I wonder if there was any backlash to this record at all anywhere recorded that parents were up in arms over it, or whether nobody gave a crap that they even took the time to listen to it, you know?
Right. Yeah. It's hard to say. I mean, well, let's discuss it begins, with probably the one track that I've remembered longer than any of them. It's the Premature Burial, Buried Alive.
Same with me. That was the one that haunted me for years.
Yeah. Cause I think I remember talking to my mother about it, and I think she told me something to the effect that, you know, this really happened to people, you know, that you know, and so, you know, listening to the track now, pretty simple, you know, in its approach. I mean, there's a lot of people crying at the beginning, and I think that they're supposed to be funeral goers.
That it's funny that you mentioned that. I wrote that in my notes. Listening to it as a kid, I thought the people crying were people that were inside their coffins realizing they had been buried alive.
Interesting.
And it wasn't until I listened to it tonight that I'm like, these are people at a funeral.
Right.
So, like, because when he was talking, he was like, many people have been buried alive over the ages. I was like, this is just a background track of, in my head, I pictured hundreds of people in coffins underground crying in terror, like, oh my God, I've been buried alive. What am I going to do? And that's why that... this track terrified me for so long.
Yeah, and it's still pretty effective. I mean, in its minimal, you know, its minimal design, you have the heartbeat that starts to come in.
Yeah.
And it picks up and you hear the scratching and the breathing, and then the heartbeat slowly starts to die down. And yeah, and then it just sort of ends, right? It ends just with this howling wind. Or I don't know what, I forget how it ends.
Well, what I thought about the ending that was creepy was they have the scratching and the banging and the knocking, and it ends with his last gasp of breath. He's like, like he just like takes his last breath,
right,
and resigns himself to like and then you're right, it's just the sound of the grave,
right?
Yeah, that's definitely one of the most terrifying ones to me. And this one is like, again, like I think we're going to keep going back to this, is just how grotesque this second half of this record
is. I mean, it brings us to the second track, which is Burned at the Stake. I think that's what the title of the track is,
right?
Does it begin with Yankee Doodle?
Yeah, it's like a drum and fife. It's like, and I didn't know when I heard that, I'm like, what is this one going to be? And he even talks about during the Revolutionary War times, and of course America was heading towards its bicentennial at this time, so it's almost like they had to toss in a little,
right,
you know, bicentennial shout out. And that one was interesting because it kind of was a story, right?
Right. Yeah, there seemed to be at least some sort of narrative you could follow. Someone's on trial and then, you know, she's screaming, "I'm not a witch." And
and it sort of had that scream again that keeps reoccurring.
Yeah, that came back, exactly.
I would say the fire was weak in that one. It didn't sound like fire burning to me. I don't know, it just sounded like a guy was crumpling up paper or something.
Yeah,
like
and there just wasn't the, I could have stood for maybe a more bloodthirsty crowd, right? To this sort of just, that would have been something to build up to. But then again, who knows? I don't know what we're supposed to believe. Were the people now in shock at what they had done or what they had seen? You know, everybody's there wanting to see it. And then when they do see it, it's more than, you know, they bargained for. But yeah.
And I was hoping it was going to end with that she really was a witch, like some sort of cackling and she flies off or something
like
that.
Yeah, I got a sense at a certain point that she was kind of putting on a witchy voice. You know, she got kind of she got kind of witchy in her sound as she was being burned.
And that would be the next one is, like we talked about at the beginning, and clearly, yeah, it was inspired by The Exorcist.
Right, right, yeah. And I mean, it's probably the longest track, I think.
I thought it was never going to end. Like, I'm like, they're really beating this.
Yeah.
And what kid at that age had seen The Exorcist to know what's going on in that scene? It's just the guy repeating over and over again, "The power of Christ compels you."
Right.
And then the banging and the sort of moaning of the, you know, if you've seen the movie, you know, it's obviously the kid on the bed banging it.
Yeah. Like, and that. I thought it was kind of neat that at the end, are we supposed to believe that she pushes him out the window?
Right.
And then he falls down the stairs.
Like the movie. Like these guys obviously saw the movie.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I, you know, I think as a kid, I didn't understand what the breaking glass was. I remember being a little confused but yeah, that wasn't too bad.
Well, isn't it interesting too that this is like you talked about at the beginning, it's theater of the mind, right?
Right.
So you're piecing this together, like being a kid back then and never having seen The Exorcist, you're like, well, shit, what is it? And you're trying to piece together what's going on, and that's what's kind of cool about this in a way. And I guess I just don't have that childhood imagination that I had, because now I can fill in the blanks with all my knowledge. But back then, I'd be like. Like I said, like with the buried alive, I thought that was hundreds of people in coffins crying that they were buried alive, not someone at a funeral.
Right, right. And I think maybe sometimes our memories of things, like even listening to this now, I think I got more chills listening to side one than I did listening to side two. Because I think side two here is trying to be a little bit more, trying to push the boundaries a little
bit.
I think the limitations of what they had to work with kind of start to come through, because the next one is the incredible giant crab. So
right.
I guess that's supposed to be crabs inhumanity to man.
Right, right,
right.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly where that fits in with the inhumanity, man's inhumanity to man theme, but yeah, that's a really, I mean, I don't know what's going on.
It's an oddly written piece too, right? Like it's like it started in the South Pacific, then it moved to Tokyo, then it made its way to San Francisco. No one can stop the incredible giant crab. Like it's trying to be like a 50s movie, but come on, no one can stop an incredible giant crab. And then it's just like the crab sounds like castanets.
Yeah, and then at some point someone's chewing an apple or something like that into a microphone. And I don't know what we're supposed... Are we supposed to be believing that the crab is crushing human skulls or something?
Or is it one person? Because like there's not like a mob of people screaming or
there's
an army fighting. It's just one woman like, oh my God, she screams for a minute.
And then the crab skull across a big kitchen floor, right?
But it did creep me out when I was a kid, because again, back to Eerie Publications, there was an Eerie Publications story I had read. I think it was Eerie, and there was a guy that was like buried up to his neck in the sand, and crabs came in off the ocean. And one of the panels I remember in the book was the crab was actually pinching the center of his eyeball and stretching his eyeball.
Oh, God.
Yeah, and so I would always equate that with this for some reason.
Mm.
Which is funny. I didn't even think about that till we started talking about this.
That's funny.
The next one was pretty interesting. That was the guillotine.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't remember that chuck sound at the end where that was pretty grotesque.
Yeah, I wrote that down myself. I said it was the most grotesque sound effect I think on the entire record.
Yeah,
and it was probably just some guy slicing a cucumber in half or something like that. But it sounded at the like it was the person choking at the same time their head was getting cut off. Like I don't know how they did it, and I was like, you know, again, it was kind of a tough one. Like these ones. It's funny, the second side, they were either really long or super short.
Yeah.
So it was like, he's like, this is the guillotine. And then you had a bunch of people yelling, off with his head, guillotine goes up, comes down.
Yeah.
And that's it.
And that's all you need.
And the next one was short too, but effective and scary. And that was the voodoo zombies.
Right. The zombies walk. When I read, I think somewhere on this record, it says zombies walk. Is it on the front? I was excited to hear it, and I was surprised to find that they didn't go with a, you know, that they brought in the voodoo side of things in the 70s, right?
Well, right, and this was prior to, if you're talking 74, yeah, sure, Night of the Living Dead had come out, but that didn't revitalize the zombie genre. Zombies right. were still very much voodoo zombies, because you had films like Sugar Hill and Scream, Blackula, Scream that use zombies, and they were all the voodoo zombies, you know, the Haiti zombies. Live and Let Die, the James Bond was Haiti zombies. It wasn't until Romero did Dawn of the Dead that really, that's where he cemented what we know as the zombie genre today.
Right.
And it was creepy. I could picture the zombies making their way through the sugarcane fields and moaning. It was another moaning, walking one. But I think you're right. On the back of the record, there was something about zombies, wasn't there?
Yeah, I can't remember where I saw it on the record, but I was curious. I was like, okay, let's. I want to hear that track when it comes up, and.
It's funny, one of the things on the records is Death Struggle of the Prehistoric Monsters. That must have been the King Kong
one. Oh, the King Kong one, right.
But yeah, that zombie one was pretty good. And then the next one we had was one that you mentioned, you talked to your mom about Buried Alive. This is one I had to ask my dad about, was the Keel Hauled one.
Right.
And again, these guys must have been film fans, because they obviously, somebody's doing a Charles Laughton from Mutiny on the Bounty, where he's like, I will have your keel hole, you know.
Yeah.
It's a very Charles Laughton-y voice. And my dad told me what keel hauls were, they hang the guy off the boat on the keel, you know, and he's just on the front of the boat as the boat goes through the water. So he's drowning, but he also gets torn apart by the barnacles that are on the bottom of the boat and things like that.
Right, and then the blood leaves a trail. And sometimes the sharks will come, yeah. And that was played really well. The guy screamed really well. The horror of the, you know, they're saying, pull him in, you know, because they see the shark come in. It's too late. Right. But that guy screaming is, he's pretty convincing. You felt his pain.
Yeah, he called, what is he, like, beggar. Too late for the poor beggar, or something like that. Like, oh, boy.
Yeah, now, go ahead.
Oh, no, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, and then, I mean, that brings us to the next one, another one of Torture Chamber, The Rack, I think it's called. That again, was what? Very short.
Yeah, and it was terrifying, because it was, again, like, it was like that guy was doing an effective, like, I'm in severe pain, terrifying scream. And then it ends, his scream goes from a manly scream to that, right into that, generics that like they stretched him so far that he's now screaming like a woman.
Oh God, yeah.
And that was pretty horrifying. But again, it was a simple one. It's just the sound of the rack and him screaming. Which again, this is like, I guess the '70s was for that, right? You know, I spit on your grave, last house on the left, like that real sort of
cruel
horror.
Yeah,
and that Grand Guillaume type stuff that was coming into play.
Yeah, and I mean, you also have to think, right? So if this was released in 74, we're right in the thick of things, right? We're coming to the end of the Vietnam War and things like that, and all of, you know, the craziness of the 60s, just I think people really were, maybe this was a way of kind of getting people to kind of feel something. Maybe they were starting to be a little desensitized by everything that they were witnessing.
Right. And I mean, I can see why, you know, you hid this, or you were terrified by this record as a child, especially at 4 years old. This would be, it's the equivalent of showing someone Last House on the Left at 4 years old, you know?
Yeah.
It's
like... And, you know, and I think... This brings up a really interesting thing, and that's that I've always really been in love with sound, right? Like, I've always just loved radio. I've loved, you know, records, story records. I love this idea of being able to have a whole film, if you will, in your brain.
Yeah.
You know, that is being triggered by these sounds. It's not unlike, you know, reading a good book, but you got that extra level where... You know, they're giving you something to kind of hold on to, and then you're painting the rest of that in your brain, and that I think that's what this record does really well. But I do question the fact that, I mean, did anybody really sit through this much? Do you think?
I don't know. I don't know if it was the type of thing that people would put it on a record and play it outside their window on Halloween as kids were coming trick or treating. Or if someone would sit down and listen to it. Now, I would sit down and listen to it. But like I said, I would only listen to the first side, because being a horror fan, I would re-listen to those stories.
Yeah.
But the second side, every once in a while, I'd be like, all right, I'm going to try it again. And that first Buried Alive track would kick in, and I'd skip over it.
Yeah.
It was terrifying, you know?
Right.
But yeah, you're right. Or... I find did anybody ever sit down and just be like, you know what? I think I just want to listen to the giant crab today for a second. Relax me as I get home from work.
Well, that's the thing, is did it have listenability or re-listenability, if that's even the right? Like, you could sit down and listen to your Peter Pan records, because they were like the little 10-minute stories or right. something, and you could listen to them again. But they're such sketches, right?
Right.
And I don't think this really even works as a sound effects record. Like, you wouldn't really want to be playing this on Halloween and while you're giving out candy.
Right.
It's too, you know, you need those, like, just where a whole side is nothing but haunted sounds.
Right. And I think what happened to me was, when I got it, at first I was disappointed because it wasn't like that. I was like, there's this narration on it. And I was mad at my mom. I'm like, the guy's talking. Like, it's not sound effects. And then I got into it. And... I mean, I would revisit this record because it was like, you know, it was just, it's such a piece of 70s horror.
Mm.
And there's nothing else like it, you know?
Yeah, there really
it's
isn't.
It's such a one-of-a-kind piece.
Right, right.
And people that know it, you know, like we talk about. So that brings us to the next one after the Torture Chamber, which is where, again, they go back to this weird 50s sci-fi with the Blob, which it's not... the Blob from the movie. They say that the Blob comes from outer space, that an astronaut picked it up while out there, and again, it was kind of, you had a lot of that, like, NASA talk.
Yeah, right, right.
And the spaceship coming back, and then you got sort of this bubbling mud or water sound, and it just sort of, you got this mob kind of yelling, you get one person gets killed.
Yeah, there's a weird point in it, right, where that you keep hearing this repeat of something. Is it supposed to be like they're outside a dance or a club?
Right.
And I could have sworn when I was listening, it sounds like they grabbed Gabba Gabba Hey, Gabba Gabba Hey, one of us from Freaks.
Oh,
I swore I could hear that. Listen to it again, but there was something, and it kept repeating. It was playing underneath, and it was like I kept hearing these voices, but they were so far back in the mix. But it kept repeating, and I was like, I don't know what...
It's funny that you filled that in your brain with that, yeah.
And I only did that now. I'm thinking to myself as I was listening to it, this was definitely just kind of a sound collage. And that's one of the things that I noticed from the Blob... and then the next one is Night of Lost Souls, right? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, Nightmare of Lost Souls.
Nightmare of Lost Souls. The Blob and the Nightmare of Lost Souls seem to just be kind of like their Revolution 9 from the White Album, where we're just gonna do these weird sound collages, and the Nightmare of Lost Souls seems to bring back a lot of sound, like the cackling of the headless horseman you hear in the background.
The crab comes back.
The crab comes back.
Which I know is supposed to be rattling bones, but it's like...
Right, yeah. So it seemed like at the end it was like, we're just going to throw all these effects together.
Right.
And make a wash of sound. And
everyone's back for one big goodbye.
Yeah.
And what I thought funny was like, that's the scream changed. They didn't use that like woman scream. They used a woman scream, but it was a different woman. And then it had that weird like that reverb effect at the end, right, where we're like bum 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 bum. Like again, like how like a 70s movie would end. Like we just saw the end of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah, you know?
It's like,
or the Philip Kaufman's Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Yeah.
And you know, it's just that. And I remember. Yeah, you're just left in the. You're left in the horror and madness of Sounds of Terror.
Right. They don't give you an out. There's no like, all right, we're bringing you out of this. Here's another Bobby Boris Pickett song.
Yeah, right.
Or here's some, or, you know, but, you know, man will stop the blob or whatever. Like,
yeah.
There's no hope. It's that nihilistic 70s, we're all screwed, like sad ending for a kid's sound effect record.
Mm.
You know, it's like there are horror movies that have happier endings than this, you know?
Yeah.
And it's funny that, you know, I mean, this is why we are the way we are, I suppose, is getting exposed to certain things like this at such a young age, 4 years old. I must have been 5 or 6 because I would have been 5 or 6 around 74.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, and I just, like I said, I've remembered this record my entire life. And it's funny that both of us through one way or another have had the exact record we had as a kid. It's still with us mentally and physically.
Yes. And I mean, this brings back something that I think you and I have talked about. I think for as much real trauma that this record caused me as a kid, I guess I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was that thing that really, really bothered me. But yet was still attractive in some way to me, right? And it's like I still would go into my record collection and sneak a peek at it once in a while. Or,
yeah.
Excuse me. But, yeah, and I've thought about it, and I'm glad that we are able to finally talk about it and share our thoughts with other people. And I'd really love to hear what other people have to say about this record if they had it, and what their experience was. How young were you when you listened to it? Did you find it as frightening as I did and you did? Maybe you didn't.
I can't imagine anybody that didn't find this frightening as a child.
Yeah.
Except for Charles Manson or somebody. But yeah, I mean, like you said, it's interesting that there are those that go to horror, get scared, get terrified, and they never go back to it.
Right.
Like, it was too scary for me. I can't do it again. And there are those like us or monster kids that go to horror, get terrified, and keep coming back.
Yes, yes. And another funny thing is that as a child, I don't think I was able to share that experience of the experience of this record with anybody.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to play it again as a child, so none of my friends got to hear it. So it wasn't until I was much older, and then when I finally met you, that I even found another person who had even heard it.
Right.
So it's one of those things that, yeah, I just kept with me. It was my own personal little piece of hell.
Yeah. And that's what I always say about like monster, I call them monster kids, but whatever. You know, fans of things like this, it's like you're part of like, in the olden times, a secret society, like a group of monks, like, I've read this tome and now I'm passing the knowledge on to you. Or we are the ones that have found this tome in the deep, dark dungeons and have looked at it and read it. And we know the knowledge of this. And when we see each other, we know, like, you have that knowledge, I have that knowledge. You know, and there's a connection there. Like, it's other people might have completely forgotten about it. So, yeah, I am interested to hear any other people's experiences with these types of records or any record from the 70s that might have terrified them. There was a lot of them out there. This is the one that I find the most terrifying, but I'm sure there are others. And, you know, please write in the comments, visit us on Facebook, or, you know, drop us a line via Telegram. Send us your cards and letters.
Yeah.
Care of your local YouTube station.
Well, this was a lot of fun. I'm really glad we got to do this. So, you think it holds up?
I think it does. I still find it to be pretty grotesque, pretty terrifying. I enjoy the first half quite a bit, a lot. I had some warm and fuzzies, actually, when hearing The Phantom of the Opera again. The second half is still unnerving.
Right. Well, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my copy and I'm going to break it into 100 pieces and I'm going to bury it. Like my father said he was going to do, going on, 40-something years ago.
Yeah. It's funny. I don't even remember my parents even knowing about this record. But yeah, that's sweet. You should take it, break it up like your dad promised. Except he lied to you.
Well, you know,
it was just sort of like you'd think that your dad would have been like, "F this thing," you know. The kid's got to be annoying, like, or he was always kind of sweet, like he was looking out for you, like, "Nah, he might want it."
Exactly, I think that's what happened. Is he knew that I was too young for it, but that someday it would, you know, the time would be right. Little did he know that it would take 40 years for me to finally sit with it and appreciate it for the work of art that it is.
Yeah, that's sweet. I think that's a good place to end. Until next time, we'll see you in the sanctum. Walk in beauty, my friends. Like before.
Tell me, was that your last picture?
I hope not.
The two of us. No boogeyman is greater than the two of us. The people scream about the team of Karloff and Price. Although we're as nice as can be, my buddy and me, there's just the two of us, and we'll be always traveling on. The two of us, there's lots of gore in pictures for the two of us. He used to shine as Frankenstein and I was the fly.
They forced us to die every time to pay for the crime.
They killed the two of us, but we'll be always traveling on.
He put up a terrific battle, ma'am, but clean living prevailed.